Do I look like I'm like leaning back but hovering? So the only thing I've got really good stomach muscles and I can just
that's a good
sit back
thing.
Like
it's
this
a,
and not
it's
worry
a
about it.
Scam we're running. The Ken Loach of gay cinema, is that
oh God.
Where you're going?
I know what Ken Loach will say about that. You're like, God, please don't. I don't know about the Ken Loach of gay cinema. That's not bad.
Well, I mean, is it gay? I mean, you're here doing Outfest, apparently,
yeah.
As we're in the lovely theater where they're showing the movie. But it doesn't inherently seem, I mean, it is gay material, but it doesn't necessarily seem like gay material.
Yeah. I mean, to me, it's not. I mean, everyone always says, is it a gay film? Is it not a gay film? And to me, it's just literally a film. I know it's a cliche to say, but I don't see it as a gay film. I see it as a film with gay characters rather than a gay film.
Is there a gay cinema of Britain that...
Not that I know of. I think there's probably been about four gay films in the last God knows how many years. And most of them are kind of bad comedies, so...
Like
I don't think
there was Poltergeist from France a couple of years ago.
Oh God, yeah. And there's been a few good British films that are about gay people, but not for a long time.
My Left Foot was.
Yeah. The King's Speech.
The King's Speech. Secretly, subtle.
Secretly.
Well, there actually had a big fight about the Dumbledore broke out because
he's gay. Yeah.
Somebody in America's Big Brother got into a fight about whether Dumbledore should be running a school if he isn't gay.
Oh, God. I love that. It becomes a big political hot point.
Yes. Very important stuff going on in Big Brother.
Yeah.
Because, you know, in America, nobody shows their boobs on Big Brother, so we have to have something to talk about.
Well, boobs are, you know. You
apparently, that's all anybody talks about in the British version of Big Brother. So.
Yeah.
So there's not a gay cinema. Is there, I mean, did you, you came up through the ranks of film schools and arts programs. So, is it different, or is it just a coincidence, or is it hard to fund, or...?
I think it's all of that. It's hard to fund. It's, you know, whenever you make a film that people think is going to be for a certain group of people or a niche, they get scared that you're not going to be able to make any money and that kind of thing, so it is difficult. But there certainly isn't, like, a gay... Like, there's no, like, queer cinema movement in the UK like there has been in the US, I think.
Right.
And that's fine. I don't need to be part of, like, a perceived movement, I think, in the UK.
Right.
So
did it die with German, or was German not seen that way?
German films?
No, Derek Jarman.
Oh, Derek Jarman, yeah. I think he's probably the last filmmaker that... But he was, because he was so pretty much experimental, he kind of stayed within that experiment. In the UK, he was probably known as an experimental filmmaker, even more than a queer filmmaker, I think. And there's people like Terence Davies, he, you know, he's a gay filmmaker, but his films aren't kind of seen as gay films.
It's a strange thing, isn't
it? It is a strange thing. You constantly have to feel like you're justifying the film you've made. And
kind of on both sides of it, though. It's almost
definitely.
Like you have to be politically correct and at the same time be...
Yeah, you've got to please everybody at the same time.
Yeah.
Instead of, I think that only really happens when you make a film that is about, you know, a minority, I suppose. Suddenly you have to represent the whole minority, and also you're trying to say that, well, it's not just about the minority and it's just a piece of cinema.
So is art house cinema, as we would call it here, is that community... healthy and thriving in the UK
that's
in general?
Relatively, I think it's getting worse, I think. I think as, you know, I don't know, as the economy gets more difficult, art house films still can cost quite a lot of money, so they're less happy to make them, I think.
Mm.
I think you can still do them if you do them on a low enough budget. But there's a lot of art house cinemas in the UK, and there are filmmakers who are, you know, making interesting things.
So as you were coming up, did you think... You know, this is going to be a fun road to be a filmmaker, or
no? I've
you
always
think it's a nightmare I'm walking myself into. Or?
Yeah, I just got to get out there and do it myself more than anything else. You know, you can wait for ages to get your film made, so it's just easier just to get whatever money you can, cobble it together, and get stuff made. I think.
So is that what you did here?
Pretty much, yeah.
So it's a handmade.
Well, we did get some money from like a public body.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it was low budget type thing, or lowish budget.
So does it surprise you that you've actually made a noise with it?
Yeah, it's amazing to us. Like, it's a small film, small British film, and it's about gay people. And it's, you know, it's got some amount of attention over here, which is incredible to us, because you never think it's going to. And a lot of British films don't even get distribution over here,
mm-hmm.
especially not small ones. So it's, you know, like, constantly surprising.
So how did you approach it?
The
in
film?
The first place, yeah. Well, I sent the script first.
Yeah, I just wrote it. I suppose I wrote it without thinking too much about what people would think about it, if people would think it was too edgy or whatever. I just wrote away and tried to be as real and as authentic as an honest as I possibly could.
Were you selling other stuff as a screenwriter at that point?
No. So,
sorry. There's vibrations everywhere where you look.
I wasn't. It was like, you know, the first thing I was kind of really sending out. And then when we got some money, I just kind of, you know, concentrated on getting it right.
Okay, so you came out of school and started writing? Or?
Oh, God, no. I did like history at university in the UK. Uh-huh. So I studied doing that, and then I worked as an assistant editor for a long time on all kinds of films, US films, UK films, but always based in England. And then I actually did a film course out in America for a year. Mm-hmm. Went back, started making some shorts, and just kind of made my way up through that, really.
So when you were sitting there cutting, were you writing on, you know, taking your lunch breaks and writing, or?
Well, trying to. Or certainly, you know, I always wanted to direct. It was not that I wanted to be an editor as such. So it was always just a way to earn money, you know, you've got to live. And
so was the opportunity just afforded itself to you or something?
No, because I made another like incredibly low budget feature that I just did because I was bored of waiting around. Mm-hmm. And so I made that for literally nothing. And then that got a bit of attention in the UK and that helped me get the money for this film. So, because mm-hmm. you can, you know, there is money in the UK, but you have to wait for it and you have to prove yourself before you can get it. And I just didn't want to wait.
How'd you end up editing in the first place?
I can't really remember. It was quite a long time ago. I think, to be honest, I was drunk in a bar and someone I knew of a job that was available on Notting Hill, actually, as like a trainee on Notting Hill. Uh-huh. So I said, yeah, that'd be good. I was working in production at the time. So I thought I'd do that and then I kind of...
Were they cutting on Avid already or was
no,
it
No, it was
on
still
film?
On film, yeah. I think that they were cutting on Avid, but there was still a film room. Right. So we were still, you know, syncing up rushes and...
You're making the transition.
Yeah, it was in that transition period.
So did you like editing?
Yes, I like editing my own stuff, and I like when you're working in the cutting room. You get to see the director working more so than you ever would on set. Mm-hmm. Like in a cutting room, there's like four of you, three of you, two of you in a room. Mm-hmm. So you get to see the decisions, and you get to see the film being put together, which you never get a chance to otherwise. And that's really interesting.
Do you think it changed how you ended up being a director?
Yeah, I think it's changed. It changed how I approach. The way I make films, mm-hmm. you know, I don't shoot hardly any coverage. I kind of try and keep it simple and, you know, less is more in my eyes. And you work on a lot of films and there's just so much coverage and it doesn't add, I don't think, often.
So not a bit, not an issue of budget as much as it is that this is really how you want to shoot.
Yeah, it's more of an aesthetic. I think even if I had $1 million to have shot the film, I would have shot it exactly the same way without, I wouldn't have changed my approach to it, I don't think.
And how did you get comfortable with the idea of working with actors?
I don't know. When you haven't worked with actors, it's always quite scary. You think, oh my God, I'm not going to understand their process and all that kind of thing. But then I think as long as you choose the right actors and you develop a relationship with them, it becomes, I don't know, I find it a really enjoyable experience to work with them.
Well, this is kind of a two-man show.
Yeah, exactly.
For the most part.
Exactly.
So it's at a very intense one for them.
Yeah.
They're going through a whole lot of layers.
Yeah, exactly.
So did you do a lot of rehearsal on this? Or did you do a lot of improv?
We did a
or?
Week of rehearsals, and we did a bit of improv. I mean, I was never really strict about how they had to be doing the script word for word. So it was always, they could try different things if they felt like it. It was more about creating an environment that they feel like they could be, you know, give their best performances. And it helps doing these long takes because they feel like they have to be on the ball from beginning to end. And we tried to make it less of a film set. So we didn't have hardly any lights, tiny crew. I didn't shout action. There was no first AD. So it was about creating a different environment that was intimate anyway. So then when you turn the camera on, it's just like, okay, so let's go.
So were you shooting both ways or were you shooting one camera?
One camera, so that, you know, there's actually, within each scene, there's no cutting within each scene. Right. So there's no actual traditional kind of coverage at all. So some of the takes like 8 minutes long without any kind of cutting. And people were like, well, you should do coverage because if the acting is bad, you are in trouble. But I thought, no, they're good. I knew they'd be good.
Right.
So you just kind of stick to those.
So you think if you weren't sure they'd be good, maybe you'd do more coverage?
No, when I met them, I was like, God, is this going to work? But then during rehearsals, I thought, no, they can pull it off. And also you're giving them the respect because you know, you say, I know you can do this. You know, and I think sometimes when you're shooting traditional coverage, you know, you've got reverse angles and someone's not doing it as well as they would have done if they know that they're both on camera and they both have to kind of engage completely.
Well, the theatre tradition, I guess,
And both the guys have done quite a lot of theatre, so, you know, they're very capable of sustaining a performance.
So once you were, you got your funding, you're heading towards set, smooth, easy, and you know that you're exactly where you want to be? Or?
It was pretty smooth. I mean, everyone that worked on the film said, God, it was really quite calm, because we shot in order as well, completely, from start to end, so no kind of flitting around with time, which I think helps. Mm-hmm. Helps performances as well. But I don't understand, I know film sets can get fraught, but I just try and make sure that they're not, because they don't need to be. Mm-hmm. I think it's a lie, as a director you need to shout at people, because you actually don't have to, and you get better, it works better, everyone's actually getting on and enjoying themselves. So we never really shot over, it was all quite contained. We shot 16 days, it's not very long, but it was relatively stress-free.
Some people like shouting.
Yeah, some people do like shouting.
It's just who they are.
Yeah, exactly. But I just think, you know, I do shout in real life all the time, but on set I try not to. Because I don't think it helps people. They just get anxious.
So you're more of a shouter in real life than you are on
set? Oh, I shout a lot in real life. Like, I'm really moody.
You seem like a nasty, nasty guy.
I'm awful. Talking. I'm terrible. To my friends, I'm dreadful. But on the film set, you make them think that you're really nice, and then they'll work hard.
So you're putting on your kindness persona.
Sure. It's all manipulation. You manipulate everybody. You just do it with a smile.
So you really are a producer, is what you're saying.
Yeah, I'm actually a terrible person.
Your dark side is coming out already.
Exactly.
So were you surprised by anything in the experience?
I think allowing yourself kind of the freedom to not be so controlling about things is really interesting. And especially with how you are with actors and how you work with actors. It's, you know, you employ people because you think they're good at their job, so you want to let them do their job. And that's really nice. I've been quite kind of controlling and storyboarding and everything being wanting it to be perfect, and I've always been disappointed. So with this, I try to be a bit looser, I suppose, with how I wanted to approach it. And that has been a really good lesson. Like, trust people around you, you know.
It's crazy.
Yeah, I know. Exactly.
So you're, this experience, does it, I mean, are you, it sounds like you careered early on in order to make a living.
Yeah.
And now you've found the place where you want to be. Is that writing, directing your future? Is that where you
definitely
see it?
Yeah.
And do you, does size matter to you in this regard? Do you want to make, you know, when they redo Harry Potter in 5 years, do you want to be there to shoot
it? I can't imagine doing the remake of Harry Potter. I don't think anyone would hire me to do that, but. I do. I mean, big is fine.
They're going gay the next time.
It's
that's the thing.
That would be good. If it's a gay Harry Potter, maybe all like in one take.
There you go.
With no real effects.
Do it all in camera.
Yeah, exactly.
Or you just need to find some wizards to be in it.
Just real wizards.
Yeah.
Maybe a documentary would be better. Documentary approach. Then maybe I'd be interested.
A mockumentary. Didn't you cut Brothers of the Head? Or no, your DP, I think, shot Brothers of the Head?
My sound editor worked
on it.
Yeah, he was on Brothers of the Head. Brothers of the Head. I would like to do bigger films, but I can't, you know. It has to be whether I really like the story. And if it's massive, that's fine, but I'd still probably want to work in the same way that I work. But if that includes famous people in the roles, that's fine, but I can't imagine I'm suddenly going to go and direct Tron 2 or 3.
Or 3. Or 4. So where do your tastes lie besides being gay?
That's the only taste I have.
That's the only thing you have? That's the only thing you've
got? That's the only way I can be defined is by being gay. That's it. I have no other facet of my personality.
What else? Is it relationship stuff that you're interested in? Is there a wider range of stuff that
It's a wider... I mean, you know, for me, the film is not about being gay. It's about, I don't know, being an outsider, or about finding out what you want to do with your life, or working out how you want to live, you know, and all those important struggles that everybody faces. That's what I'm interested in. You know, issues of identity and definition and all those kind of things. And so I think for me, when you make a film, just because they're gay, that's a way for me to explore those themes that I'm interested in. But of course, when they're gay characters, suddenly everybody's like focusing on the gay, when of course there's other like issues below. So for me, you know, I'm not going to only make films about gay characters.
Well, the Loach reference to begin with, the whole thing was like, because it you're kind of doing a lot of what he does,
yeah,
and what, you know, Mike Lee does sometimes, you know, there's that you're exploring a small story.
Definitely.
You're exploring intimate characters. And in this case, they just happened to be... Those guys could have been a man and a woman.
Exactly.
Having
exactly.
a lot of the same dialogue, yeah. a lot of the same things going on yeah. in the story.
It's just they're men.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, it's funny. I saw Friends with Benefits last night, which is coming out.
Yeah.
Could have been two men.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
know? And maybe was. I don't know.
But it's true. But nobody, you know, when it's like Friends with Benefits and it's a man and a woman, nobody like yeah. says, oh, you know. Are gay people ever going to go and see that film? I mean, surely only, you know, straight people will see that film, but nobody questions that. Whereas if we make a gay film, it's like...
Well, there's a controversy on that film that Woody Harrelson plays a gay
oh,
man.
He does, doesn't he? I've heard of
and
that,
And he's
yeah.
perfectly fine. He is not... Yeah. There's nothing that identifies him as gay
it's
other
not
than
too
him continuing to say, I'd like some cock now, please. Yeah. You know, he literally he says that, I think, at one point in the movie. Let's go cock something. But, you know, but he has some lines, but basically, he's like what you would have as a straight guy yeah. character, chasing women instead of exactly. he's chasing men occasionally. You know?
I think when people realize that gay people are actually just people, they have yeah. like their own lives just like everyone else.
We're slowly figuring this out in the country.
Yeah, it's taking a long time.
Is it as the same in the UK?
Yeah, it's pretty much the same. I think, and maybe cinema doesn't actually help that particularly because a lot of depictions of gay characters are often quite stereotypical and it just takes a while for people maybe to realize that.
Well, what you said earlier, I think, is completely true, is that you end up being the representative of everything.
Yeah.
Because there are only so many films that get traction that are
exactly.
for an ethnic group or for gay or for lesbians yeah. or whatever. And you end up, everybody obsesses on, you know, why isn't this story telling everybody, you know,
exactly.
the story of gay world. It's like,
I mean, you're
not
supposed to represent everybody. Yeah. And it's like, well, it's actually just a story about two people.
And you can't.
No.
I mean, you can't do it with straight people. You can't do it with gay
and
people.
Why would you
do
want
it with...
to? Like, that's not, you know, yeah. that's not interesting. And also, it's like you make a film about gay characters, and obviously these characters are flawed individuals who make mistakes, and they can be stupid and all that kind of thing. But sometimes people don't like to see that either. So for me, it's just about making well-rounded characters.
Of course, the interesting dichotomy is that festivals like Outfest here in Los Angeles, but all around the country, really,
yeah.
pick up on these films. Sometimes yeah. that don't even have gay themes, that are just made by a gay filmmaker.
Yeah.
And somehow... It's both a ghetto and a way to promote a film
yeah.
and get it out there, you know.
And also it is good for festivals like this to have, you know, to have a space where they can show all these films that are about kind of the gay experience.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really good that that exists and it should exist, I think. So it's good.
Until we're ready to actually get over it.
Until we're ready to get over it.
Which would be really nice soon.
Yeah.
Because I'm tired of talking about it, honestly.
It's like, I know, exactly.
After it's all like, these oh. years, it's like,
yeah.
okay, yeah, and?
And it'd be nice when a kid can come out as being gay and it isn't an issue and he can just say, oh, I'm gay now, and that's fine. You know, and yeah. he lives in Arkansas, you know, and it's like, oh, hi, everyone, I'm gay, and no one cares. That would be great.
Yeah.
So.
No, it's
one
still,
day, maybe.
It's still kind of stunning that it's an ongoing... Yeah. But we're getting better,
exactly.
slowly but surely.
Exactly.
So what comes next for you?
I've got a few kind of projects in early kind of development that I'm trying to kind of work on. And
so you're overcutting. You're not going to go back to the editing room for
no,
some
no.
movie?
No, I don't think so. No, I wouldn't. Unless, no, I wouldn't. Because it's funny,
not.
Because it's actually interesting. You end up, it's like being defined as gay. Mm-hmm. If you end up going back to editing, you're... someone that works in editing that sometimes directs. It's like mm-hmm. everything you do, people are very much, very happy to stick a little label on you, very, in whatever form that is.
Yeah.
And so it's weird. You have to kind of pick your ground and say, okay, I'm going to be defined by this now. I'm going to be seen as a writer and director, not as a writer-director that edits most of the time.
Right. So do you have a film community that you feel supports what you're doing, that is around you in the UK? That...
Not really. I always feel, it's strange, I feel like I'm kind of not quite part of the British filmmaking community,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not part of the American or straight. I feel like I'm somewhere in a boat in the mid-Atlantic, just like bobbing around, trying to find which bit I should go to.
Huh.
And it's funny, because this film has only been shown in America so far, it hasn't even been seen in the UK,
hmm.
so it's going to be interesting to see what happens when it plays in the UK and what the response is there. And it's been getting a good response here, but you know, who knows how it will be seen in the UK, so it's interesting.
And I couldn't quite tell from the press notes, but I got the impression that at least one of the actors is straight.
Yes. Although, it's one of those things that I hate to talk about, because then people are like, well, you know, does that mean it's not real enough? Or it always becomes an issue, and you end up debating it, and whether they should both be gay, or whether it matters, or... You know.
Or is it artistically an issue? I mean, with McKellen and others being out for so long,
yeah,
it seems like, and still playing heterosexual roles, openly heterosexual roles, where they actually look at women and drool and things.
Yeah.
But, you know, that line seems to be a little bit less blurry more blurry.
I still think it's harder for a gay actor to kind of...
Play straight.
I mean, it's fine. You know, you can be Colin Firth and play gay, and that's great, and you win an Oscar.
So the straight actor is, in some ways, going to be lauded for playing gay?
Well, that's what I always find it very weird, that if you're straight and you play gay, it's like, oh, congratulations, you did so well at playing gay. I don't even know what that means. You know what I mean? It's like, these are characters who have numerous parts of their personality, and the fact that they fancy men is a small part of that.
Mm-hmm.
And so the gay actor is just as good as the straight actor, you know, but it's a, because he's gay in real life, it's like, well, you know, must have been easier for you. Well, of course not.
Right.
It's no different.
Well, Colin in that role, particularly, you know, going through the loss, was really what the character was about. It really, the gayness of it was really a minor issue.
It was so minor in that film, I think, really. And
except that I guess the sense is that a heterosexual man doesn't express himself as, but his whole thing was that he was hiding it.
Yeah,
also,
and he he was so repressed in that film. And everyone's like, oh, well done, Colin, you can play gay. And Colin's felt great about it. When you hear him talk about it, it's like, you know, the fact that he was gay was completely irrelevant.
Yeah.
But I think sometimes, I don't know, maybe it makes people feel more comfortable and they think, I don't know, it's a strange world.
It is a strange world. So do you have distribution at home?
Yes. Yeah, we do.
So you're already that guy. And you have distribution coming out of the festivals here?
Yep. So we have distribution here, theatrical distribution in September, and in a few other countries, in Germany and France and Brazil and Poland, strangely. So, yeah.
So you got to knock the next film out of the pipe. They're going to be expecting films from you.
Yeah, so I need to stop traveling to festivals and promoting the film and actually do some work and get down and write rather than...
Are you enjoying that or is it distracting at this point? As you love this festival,
I love it. It's great to be at festivals and it's great to meet people and all that kind of thing. And you think you're going to do some work while you're out here, but of course you don't.
Right.
Because you're out all the time and meeting people and drunk and...
Well, it's like in the award season, we always, you know, everybody's very happy to be nominated and it's all very lovely. And you get to week, you know, second or third month of it, and you see that look of panache, their faces are like, how can I get out of here?
Yeah.
What have I gotten myself into? I mean, it's going to be really nice to dress up and go to the award show, but this is kind of a nightmare.
And also, you make a film and you finish your film and you spend all that time and then you're done and you think, okay, it's over now. And then, of course, it's not over. You've got like another year of having to talk about it, which is good because you want to get the film out there, but... You know.
Well, a lot of filmmakers, that becomes their entire career. I mean, that's when it's a little scary. It's like, you know, they get on the circuit, the film is good enough to get into a bunch of festivals, and they travel and they travel and they travel, and then at the end, they're like, they haven't written the next film, they haven't, you know, they're not prepared to do another movie, and if it didn't sell and become an event, they're kind of screwed.
And then it's 4 years later, and they you know, haven't made anything.
And they're editing.
And they're editing.
They're cutting beautifully.
And they're stuck in a little room somewhere, alone. Yeah.
Which is ultimately, I guess, the dream of a filmmaker.
Yes.
To be stuck alone in a room.
Exactly.
Do you like that part of it? I mean, you must...
I do quite like it. I mean, it's funny. You're all completely alone, and then suddenly you're on a film set, and there's loads and loads of people, and then it's nice because you're back again, and it's just you... Because I edit my own stuff, it's just me in my bedroom, usually, editing my film.
On what computer program?
Final Cut.
So, do you hate the new Final Cut Pro?
I've not even seen it yet. Everyone says it's really bad.
Is it released in the UK, or is it...
No, I think it's been... Is it released here now?
It just came, a few weeks ago.
It's cheaper, though, which maybe is a good thing.
$300.
That is cheap, but...
It's much cheaper.
I don't know what it's going to be. I think if it's more like iMovie, then it'd be awful.
My cameraman will tell you how much it's like iMovie.
Oh, really?
The world. He's never used it, but he hates it.
iMovie, I don't even know how to use it. It doesn't make any sense to me. But Final Cut's been quite good. I'll just stick with my old program.
You stay with what you got.
Yeah.
Keep on going.
Exactly.
And typing away in a room at this point?
Yes. I usually write my stuff like longhand and then
try. So you're old school?
Yeah. On a big old typewriter.
Really? Write longhand and then
it's
you
like
type it?
It's like Murder, She Wrote in my house. Sitting there with a wig on and a big old typewriter.
That's very Angela Lansbury of you. I think I've seen that movie too.
Yeah.
It was really good. And do you enjoy Los Angeles? Do you have dreams?
I do like it.
Someday coming to Hollywood and making a Murder, She Wrote episode? Or
that's my dream, actually. I'm going to resurrect Murder, She Wrote and have a new version of it.
The drag Murder, She Wrote. I think, see, again, I'm not putting you in the box, but
there you go.
It's funny.
RuPaul in Murder, She Wrote.
No, it would have to be more subtle, like Rupert Everett.
Yeah, there you go.
He could do it, too.
He could do it.
You know, he'd have to bring it down a little bit.
Yeah, he'd have to be more kind
a little
of
too more subtle.
Yeah. He's probably a bit too old now. He's probably older than Angela Lansbury.
He's almost as... he's older than Angela Lansbury. Wow. That's a little scary. I didn't know that was possible. They actually, like, crate her out. They're going to roll her out on Broadway. Yeah. And she actually works on Broadway still.
I know.
She still does 8 shows a week.
But she's looked the same forever.
Yeah.
Go back to Manchurian Candidate. She looks the same.
Pretty close. I remember Bed Knobs and Broomsticks. Yeah. That was my first Angela Lansbury thing, I think.
Yeah.
And she hasn't changed a bit.
No. She's great.
And she's still lovely and charming. And theatre for you, is that part of your...
I've never thought about theatre. I mean, I'd like to do some theatre. I think it'd be interesting to give it a go. But, I don't know, I think cinematically rather than theatrically. Even if my stuff can sometimes feel quite like it could be a stage play, I don't think in terms of theatre, I don't think.
It seems like a British thing to do.
Yeah.
So are there two-man show, a lot of two-man theatre kind of things?
There's a lot of theatres in London.
There's all kinds of theatres to fill.
All kinds of theatres to fill. So there's a lot of stuff. Not always good.
No, but it is a cultural mecca.
Yeah, definitely.
It's actually interesting to see, because in Broadway it's become so expensive to put anything up.
Yeah.
That, you know, places like the Chocolate Factory and whatever in London
have
become
really good.
Important to Broadway
yeah.
just to feed the machine.
From a tiny little theatre in London.
Yeah. It's a good thing.
Yeah.
And are you enjoying Los Angeles?
Yes, I like it.
Even though you're drunk and partying all night?
Yeah. Apart from you can't get around and you get stuck in traffic for hours and hours and hours. Apart from that, I like it.
It's a dream town.
It's a dream town.
And it almost never rains.
Anything. It never rains. I'm hoping that it rains during Carmageddon. Because then it really will be the end of all time in LA. People will be like, oh my God, I saw today. And they'll be like,
happens during Carmageddon, though, nobody would leave their house anyway.
That's true.
It would be confusing because people would actually leave their home here.
Yeah.
So you're already Carmageddoned up.
Yeah, I'm excited.
You're like very LA.
I'm looking forward to it.
This is like having a live action version of Volcano or something.
Yeah, well, I think Michael Bay should make a film about it. It's like Transformers with Armageddon. I mean, it's there.
It all comes together.
Yeah.
Maybe you should do it.
This
is the secret thing that you've been waiting to do all of your life.
I want to make a film about Armageddon.
Just get your, you know, iPhone out there.
Yeah, and I can make it.
Shoot it on the iPhone.
Yeah.
The thing.